today we're going to expand our knowledge on atoms. We already know that atoms are the smallest particle of an element. And we know this through indirect observation. So we can't see atoms. They're extremely small. But we know that they are there, and we know how they behave and what makes up atoms, because we have done experiments where we haven't actually seen them, but we can see how atoms affect things. We call those indirect observations. One particular indirect observation was performed by a scientist by the name of Rutherford, and he did an experiment called the gold foil experiment. And this is what he did. He took alpha particles, which are positively charged particles, and he shot them at a very thin piece of gold foil, which would be made of gold atoms. And he had a screen that went all the way around the foil, and wherever the particles ended up, they would basically light up the screen there. So we would be able to see, we knew where they started, but we also were able to see where they ended on the screen. So two particular things were of interest when we see the results of this. First of all, most of the particles that were shot through the gold foil went straight through to the other side on this side of the screen. So because most of them went through, we can say, or we can assume or infer, that most of those gold atoms are made of empty space. But some of them did not go straight through. Some of them were deflected, meaning that they went off at different angles. And so I saw that it came out on over here and over here, for example. What this tells us is that those positively charged particles must have hit something in the atom. So because some of them were deflected, first of all, we know that most of them were not deflected. They went straight through. So most of it is empty space. So we know that whatever they hit must be very small. And we know that they must be positively charged, because our particles here were positively charged. So likes repel, right? Positive and positive, they're not going to want to go together. They repel. And that's what happened here. The alpha particle was positive, it hit the positive nucleus, and that caused it to go off at these different angles. That center, which has an overall positive charge, is called our atom's nucleus. The nucleus is in the center of the atom, as I said before. And when we think about atoms, we tend to draw them as what we call Bohr models. Bohr is another scientist that dealt with atoms, which we will talk about more later. And we draw these to make atoms more simplified, because electrons moving around in these perfect circles are not, that's not what's actually happening in an atom. It's more complicated than that, but to make it simpler for ourselves, we create this model. So, in our nucleus, we have two types of subatomic particles. Subatomic particles are just particles that are smaller than an atom. So I have protons and neutrons in my nucleus. Protons are abbreviated as P+, because protons have a positive charge. Neutrons are abbreviated as N with a zero, because neutrons do not have a charge at all, or we say that they are neutral. The mass of my protons and my neutrons are 1 AMU each. AMU stands for atomic mass unit. This is basically a made-up unit that scientists came up with, because the actual mass of a proton is 1.6 times 10 to the negative 24th grams. And as we recall from scientific notation, this is extremely, extremely small. So instead of saying this all the time, they decided to make this its own unit, which is an atomic mass unit. So protons and neutrons have approximately the same mass. Electrons are not in the nucleus. They are on these orbits that go around the nucleus, which we call energy levels. So here I have my nucleus, and then I have an energy level here, and I have another energy level here. So I can have multiple energy levels depending on how many electrons there are. So the electrons will be found in the energy levels, and I abbreviate that as E with a negative sign. The negative sign is because electrons have a negative charge. But notice that the mass of my electrons is different from my protons and my neutrons. My mass down here for electrons is a fraction, and it's a very, very, very small fraction. What this means is that if I wanted to have the same amount of mass for protons and electrons in each of my hands, in one hand I would have one proton, and in the other hand I would need to have 1,836 electrons. So electrons are extremely small compared to both protons and neutrons. Okay, so on our periodic table, we have information like this. So this is the information we would have for helium, for example. The number on the top is called the atomic number, and sometimes it's not on the top. I should rephrase that. The whole number, so it doesn't have any decimal point, that's the atomic number. The number that does have a decimal point is called the atoms, or that element's atomic mass. If I round this number, I will get what is called the mass number for that element. These two numbers, the atomic number and the mass number, are very important because they can tell us how many protons, neutrons, and electrons each of our elements has. So to figure out how many protons an element or an atom of that element has, we look at the atomic number. To figure out how many electrons there are, that needs to be the same as the number of protons, because my negative charges from my electrons and my positive charges from my protons need to be the same. So in actuality, the atomic number technically tells us both how many protons there are and how many electrons there are in an atom. The atomic number is important for us because it tells us what element we're talking about. So if I tell you that the atomic number is 2, like it is here, you know that I'm talking about helium. No other element has an atomic number of 2. They each have a different atomic number. The number of protons plus the number of neutrons, so everything in my nucleus, is called the mass number. And I can determine that by rounding my atomic mass like we said before. To figure out how many neutrons there are on their own then, I would take the mass number, because that's the protons and neutrons together, minus the protons. So take away the protons and you're left with just the neutrons. So for helium, the atomic number is 2. So right away I know I have 2 protons, and right away I know I have 2 electrons. No math needed for those two. For the neutrons, however, I have to do a little math. I have to round this, which would just be 4, and I subtract how many protons I had from it. So 4 minus 2 gives me those 2 neutrons. So now I can draw a Bohr model of this. My protons and my neutrons go in the nucleus. My electrons go into the energy levels. So I have my nucleus, and then I only have one energy level needed for those 2 electrons, because 2 electrons can go in the first energy level, 8 electrons can go in the second energy level. So if I had more than 2 electrons, I would put the first 2 in this first energy level, and then I would need another energy level around that one to put any additional electrons. We also have something called isotopes. Isotopes are atoms that have the same number of protons. So let's think about that. If they have the same number of protons, that means they have the same atomic number, which means they are the same element. However, they're different because they have a different number of neutrons in their nuclei, or their nucleus plural. So for example, lithium has 2 common isotopes, lithium-6 and lithium-7. The number that comes after the dash is that is that isotope's mass number. So here's the information I can get from my periodic table, and I can see that lithium, no matter what mass number it has, always has 3 protons. And because it has 3 protons, I know it has to have 3 electrons. My positives and my negatives are the same. The neutrons are where I do my math. So I take the mass number for lithium, which is 6, minus the protons, which is 3, to find out that there are 3 neutrons in lithium 6. Lithium 7, I'm going to take the mass number 7 minus the protons 3 to get 7 minus 3, or 4 neutrons. So again, same number of protons, different number of neutrons. And notice that because they have different numbers of neutrons, they also have different mass numbers. So we've been focusing on mass number instead of atomic mass. And we notice that they're similar. To get the mass number from the periodic table, I just round the atomic mass that is on the periodic table. So I round it up. If it's greater than 0.5, I keep it the same. If it's less than 0.5. But let's talk about what atomic mass actually is. So atomic mass takes into account all of the isotopes for each of those elements on our periodic table. And we average them. It's a weighted average. So I'll give you an example. Let's use lithium 7 and lithium 6 like we did before. Scientists have determined that about 92.5% of all of the lithium that we know of is lithium 7, and that about 7.5% of lithium is lithium 6. So to determine what the atomic mass is for this element, I would take the mass number 7 times the by the percent in its decimal form, so in as 0.925, so I just moved it over 2 places to get 6.475. I do the same thing for the other isotope. So I take 6, which is the mass number, times 0.075, because I moved this over 2 places, and I get 0.45. I add those together to get 6.93. Now, when I look at a periodic table, it tells me that the atomic mass is 6.94. That's because there are other isotopes for lithium other than lithium 7 and lithium 6. Notice that I said about 92.5 and about 7.5. So there's a little bit that exists that are different isotopes, and that's what makes up for that 0.01 difference between what we calculated and what's actually on our periodic table.